half. And also I'll pass a link to the lecture notes of the next lecture by Stefano ALLESINA in the YouTube chat, so you can also get the material there. And let's wait for the people on Zoom to join back, and then we can start. Okay, so I think people are back. Great. So before I introduce the next speaker, just the usual info about an etiquette. So if you want to ask a question, please either post it in the Zoom chat or use the raise hand tool on Zoom that you can find under participants. There are three dots and you can raise hand. And when I think Stefano will stop every now and then to leave time for questions, then I'll sort of give you the possibility to talk, or I'll ask the question on your behalf. And another point, I saw in the breakout rooms that there are many people that are alone in a room waiting for others to join. If you have the version Zoom 5 installed, which you can install for free, you have the possibility to change rooms. So if you are alone and there is no one to chat with you, you can also change room and find someone else to chat with. So great. So after this, it's my great pleasure to introduce the next lecturer, Stefano ALLESINA. Stefano got his PhD from the University of Parma, and after a postdoc at the University of Michigan and at Nansis, he moved to Chicago, where he's currently a professor in the Department of Ecology and Evolution. His most recent research has been focused on the theoretical understanding of large ecological communities, and he will give three lectures on the theory of ecological assembly. So thank you very much, Stefano, for being with us. And yes.
Thank you, Jacopo. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. So my name is Stefano. I'm broadcasting from the beautiful campus at the University of Chicago, where the weather is nice but a bit cold. And yes, I have three lectures on some sort of like theory of assembly of ecological communities. These three lectures, unfortunately, are not exactly the same length. So don't worry if we cannot go through the whole first lecture. The other ones are a little shorter. So we'll see, we'll take it as it comes. And so I have very extensive lecture notes that I'm posting on GitHub. I actually put the link to the lecture notes and the GitHub repository in the chat. And the idea is basically that you can build all these lectures on your own computer. And in fact, you can play with all the code that is provided. To do that, you need to install R, and then you need like these packages, right, that will be needed for the calculations. In terms of questions, like that Jacopo was discussing before, I would like maybe divide them in two categories. The first category is questions that are really like needed for understanding what's going on. So if Jacopo, that is manning the chat, sees anything that means like people are not following, just interrupt me. And in fact, like somebody already saying, I cannot download the lecture notes. So like if you click on this link, right, that is provided, and then you go here in code, and then you say download zip, you can download the zip file with all the lecture notes. And to see the lecture notes, you can just put this address that they put in the chat in your browser, and you should be able to follow the lectures. I follow these lectures religiously because I wrote them especially for these series of classes. And so you should be able to follow precisely what I'm doing. Then there's other types of questions which are like curiosities or like extensions or things like that. Those I will try to keep for maybe the last 5 minutes or so. All right. That said, we can get started. And I just give a very brief, very partial overview of the history of ecological assembly. What is ecological assembly? It's simply like the process by which ecological communities are built. So you can imagine that there's a process by which species enter in a certain system, right? Increasing the richness, like the number of species in the system. And then there's the opposite process, which is like extinctions, by which some species disappear from the system, right? So the interplay between these kind of colonization, invasion, or immigration and extinction create like some sort of balance by which we build these ecological communities. The typical setting actually is something like this, right? That we have some sort of mainland or like meta community. Imagine like a bunch of species, and here each species is a different like symbol. And then every so often we have this immigration event, right? Like this idea for which like a certain species, say this diamond species, entered the system here in this island or local habitat or however you want to call it. And now these two species, for example, can start interacting. And what is the outcome of this interaction? Maybe these two species will coexist in the local habitat slash island, or maybe one of the two will go extinct, or maybe both of them will go extinct, right? So we have different outcomes. And then after a while, maybe this other species like triangle comes back into the system. And then again, we restart the dynamics. So this is basically the idea of this ecological assembly. Historically, this type of island, mainland type of model has been contrasted with other models that instead are based on species traits. So now we're thinking there is a certain environment, this environment, a certain condition, you can imagine like temperature, right? And so maybe some species will thrive at this temperature because of their traits, and some other will not be able to grow. And as such, what the environment does is impose a sort of selection on the traits of these species. So these models are more focused on traits of the species rather than their identity. And this process by which the environment selects for certain species and not others is called environmental filtering, right? And so you can read a lot about environmental filtering. And this typically leads to what? To the fact that we're selecting for certain traits, right? So the traits will cluster together, something that we call trait under dispersion. Now, of course, species can interact with each other, right? And imagine that we have a community of competitors. Then these competitors are competing for the shared resources. And as such, they cannot really coexist if they're too similar in their requirement of their resources. And this would lead to what? To a separation of the traits of the species. So the opposite of like this convergence that we were seeing before. And this is called over-dispersion. And again, this is like a view of this assembly based on traits rather than on species identity. These themes went on for basically forever, like as long as the discipline of ecology. And in fact, like I put here like a book that is like 25 years of discussions on assembly. And reading this book, I was really like taken by the introduction, because the introduction, I suggest reading it, like maybe without too many prejudice. But it is a very forceful introduction and somewhat bizarre. And in fact, that immediately after, I found this review by Nick Gotelli in 1999, that again picks up on this introduction, saying that the language of the introduction is an embarrassment to the discipline. Which also tells you that not only this is a very old problem, right, that of the ecological assembly, but it's in fact one of the most debated, heatedly debated problems in ecology. If we go back in history, as I was saying, this is very old history, we can find examples in 1899 when Henry Coles, actually he was at the University of Chicago, and he developed this theory that we call the theory of succession, by looking at the Indiana Dunes, which like are basically half an hour south of my office on the shore of Lake Michigan. And so you have these sand dunes that you can imagine like start building up, and what happens is that some species land on these like sandy dunes and are able to colonize these sandy dunes. We call these the pioneer species, right? And by doing this, they stabilize these dunes somewhat, and they allow for other species to come in, right? And so we have this kind of sequence of species coming in and replacing, in fact, each other to some extent. And what is very interesting is that because there's so much like wind in Lake Michigan, every so often these dunes are blown out. And so the process restarts. And you can basically date the dunes. How long has this dune been developing for? By looking at the vegetation. So what you can really do is some sort of like substitution of space for time, right? Like that by looking at different places, I can see dunes of different ages. And as such, I can basically reconstruct this succession of vegetation along these dunes. And Coles, and in fact, like even other people like Clements, held this very strong view that this was somewhat of a regular, ordered, deterministic process, right? Like that there is like this sequence that each dune follows pretty much with some fidelity, like the same sequence of vegetation. This is in very much of a contrast with, like, for example, the view of Gleason that in 1920s started advocating for a much greater role of chance, right? So a lot of the debates we will see, like Democritus, like the Greek philosopher, would be pleased that a lot of these discussions are chance versus necessity, right? Like that a lot of this has this very basic philosophical point at the back. Another case like of something that created a huge debate in the literature is the work of Jared Diamond, who was studying avian like bird assemblages in island off the coast of New Guinea. And what he noticed is that certain combination of species were never observed. He called these forbidden combinations. And the idea was that these were prevented from happening by competition, for example. And the idea there is like, now if I look at all the islands, right, and I look at all the possible patterns and I see which one are forbidden, maybe I can learn the rules of the game of assembly by reconstructing it like in this inverse way, right, of looking at all these combinations and then finding what's going on in the background. This work, needless to say, caused an intensive debate, like what is called like the null model wars that occupied ecologists for a lot of like the 1980s and 1990s. And again, are these patterns that we are observing the outcome of some deterministic necessary process, or rather they arise by chance? And this actually led to a fantastic like development of null models of like, what should we expect when we have a certain number of species interacting? With which probability are we going to observe these particular like sequence of presences and absences? And this work was spearheaded by Dan Simberloff, Connor, Gotelli. There are very, very good reviews. I'm pointing here to a book on null models in ecology. Again, like chance versus necessity, if we look at the early 2000s, like the work of Steve Hubble on neutral theory, right? What should we expect if species were simply not to interact or were somewhat equivalent? In that case, like what we observe in terms of pattern, for example, species abundance distribution would be basically driven by stochastic fluctuations, right? Species would take a random walk in this space and then we would end up with some sort of like statistics. And sure enough, like the statistics that we can observe and measure in nature are somewhat compatible with this assumption of neutrality. And again, this sparked an immense debate facing like neutrality versus, again, like necessity represented here by niche dynamics, meaning like these are driven by species interactions, like competition, like trade, like avoidance, in fact, of competition to some extent. Finally, I'm just gonna, as you can see, like here you have like readings for several years of studies. Another idea that kind of came out of this assembly is the idea of community phylogenetics, right? We know that we can reconstruct to some extent, like the evolutionary history of species, and that this evolutionary history gives us a lot of information on what happens in terms of traits and resource utilization and whatnot. And such, like what you would think is that you can relate phylogenetic data, so for example, phylogenetic trees, with a community ecology, right? And so this idea of community phylogenetics is exactly centered on this. the history of community ecology from like late in the 19th century up to today. What I'm gonna do today is actually take like some sort of like an older view. This is like models that were developed when I was, say, in high school, you know, like or early in my college years, and so we will examine some sort of a basic model of ecological assembly, and we will try to ask some sort of intelligent questions, and for which we can get an answer when we make a certain number of assumptions. For our exploration, just to keep things simple, what I would like to use is like what is arguably like the simplest model for population dynamics, which is like the generalized Lotka-Volterra model. Maybe you've seen it in a different form. Let me just write it in component form first. So this, you have, it's one of like the six equations that we teach all the ecologists in the world, right? So we're following like the density of population, say I at time t, and we're following this population in time. So we write a differential equation. And typically what we write is like xi, so the population density itself, times ri. Ri is what? Like is the intrinsic growth rate. You can think of this growth rate as like the growth rate that this population would have when grown alone at very, very low density. This in fact can serve as two purposes, like a growth rate if this is positive, or a death rate if this is negative, right? If I put lions, you know, like in a nice field with no animals to eat, they will die. And then we have the interaction part, like we, these species interact with all the other species to some extent in the community. So we take like the sum over J of Aij, and then the density of species J at time t. So this is like in component form. I rather prefer writing this in matrix form, which basically say this is a vector now of growth rate, dx dt, and d of x here with big D means like a diagonal matrix with x on the diagonal. And how come that I have all these things written here? And then R now will be what? Like a vector of growth rates, of intrinsic growth rates, and A is now a matrix of interactions, okay? And I assume there are N species, and like I just labeled the species from one to N in whatever order you prefer. All right. So for a single species, and maybe you've seen this when you've done the tutorial on nonlinear dynamics, this model can only have very, very few outcomes. They're not especially interesting. So a species by itself can either grow exponentially, it can decay exponentially and then go extinct, or it can reach some sort of an equilibrium, like some level at which it stops growing or shrinking. When we include two or more species, we can have like cycles, neutral cycles, or even like limit cycles that could even be stable, like meaning attracting different trajectories to the same limit cycle. And with three or more species, we can even find chaos, like chaotic dynamics. So I have code in the repository that you can download to integrate like the dynamics of this model. And here I'm just loading a particular example that I found just like by searching, in which we have a certain matrix of interaction A and a certain growth rate R, such that when we integrate the dynamics, what you see here is that this species keeps cycling for forever. Like this is a good example of a limit cycle, right? So the species will not stop the dynamics ever. They will oscillate up and down in this fashion for forever, okay? So this is one of the cases of limit cycle. You can find similar cases with like chaotic dynamics, which you can think of as like cycles that, however, never close on themselves, right? They're non-periodic cycles. All right. One thing that we can do in this model, which is in fact the simplest thing that we can do in this model, is to look for fixed points, right? So are there particular densities of the species? Imagine like a vector of density such that the dynamics at that point are fixed, right? They stop like moving. And because of the form of the equations, right? Like what do we have? Let me maybe put an annotation here, right? So our equation is like d of x times r plus ax, and this has to be zero for the dynamics to have stopped. And so you can see that there's basically two cases. Either this part is zero, right? Like the part we multiply something by zero and then it's zero. Or the part within the parentheses is zero, which is more interesting, right? Because in this case, the species might be present at a positive density. So then let's try to find the solution. The solution exists when this matrix A is not singular, and I've seen that Zach just taught you like a bit of linear algebra. So now you know what I'm talking about. And so basically we want to solve A of X plus R is equal to zero, which we can write as A of X is equal to minus R. And so like what we would like to do is to somewhat divide by this matrix. Of course, you cannot divide by a matrix, but what you can do is to multiply by the inverse of this matrix both sides, and then you find the solution, right? You find the solution as long as this matrix is not singular, meaning there's no zero eigenvalue. Now we get a solution. It could be a solution that contains some negative numbers. And even for a theoretician, I've never seen minus three turtles or like minus seven elephants. So these would not really be a feasible solution to our system, because like species have to have positive or at least non-negative density. But if such a point exists, right? So if we have a solution for the system that is all positive components, we call this a feasible equilibrium for the system. And it is unique, right? Because we're solving a system of linear equation that has a single a solution as long as A is not a singular itself. In R, right, you have code in R to do what? To solve like the system, you know, if I want to solve AX is equal to B, I can call solve of A comma B, right? And so we just do that with A, and RB is gonna be minus R, right? And so if we do this for the system above, like the one with the limit cycle that we had above, what we find is that there is a positive feasible equilibrium, right? And so these are like the numbers here. And in fact, if you go in the plot again, these horizontal line that are dashed here, this is exactly the solution of this thing. And you can see like that, for example, this purple species oscillates up and down, and the equilibrium is contained in the range of this oscillation. And the same is true for green, the same is true for red, the same is true for blue. Okay, that kind of gives us some idea of what's going on. In fact, you can even do a little more. I didn't include like the theorem or the proof here, but you can see Hofbauer and Sigmund, the book that is referenced here. You can show that to have coexistence of a certain number of species in generalized logical Volterra, you have to have a feasible equilibrium in the interior, right? So you have to have a point where all the densities are positive that is an equilibrium for the system. Now, this equilibrium might be stable or unstable. And of course, like to have, for example, limit cycles or to have chaos, you need like an unstable equilibrium. While if you want to have all the dynamics to all the trajectories to converge to this point has to be stable. So next, what should we do? We should think about stability. So have you covered like local stability analysis? It's my question for Jacopo or for whoever can answer in the notes, or should I go over it? Like
we have, I mean, it was discussed in one of the tutorials, but I think it's always good to, I mean, very quickly remind the audience.
Right. So just like as a reminder, because you already should know about this, but maybe you forgot. So we have a fixed point, right? So we have some point at which like dynamics are stopping. And what we want to do is to say, okay, but are trajectories that start very, very close to this point gonna converge to this point, or rather they're gonna spiral away and some species will go extinct, right? So if we want to have like coexistence at an equilibrium point, it better be attractive, right? Like you should have like that if you perturb the densities of the species a little bit, nothing much is gonna happen. And the way you do this type of analysis, in fact, is to take like the system, put it at equilibrium, and then tailor expand around it, right? Like, and if you tailor expand like the dynamics, so imagine that I'm saying just like something like I want to track in time. Let me just put an annotation. I want to track in time what the perturbation, say dx, d of delta x in time, right? So imagine this delta x is like my equilibrium plus minus some very small quantity, in fact, infinitesimally small quantity. And then if I Taylor expand this, what do I get? Like I should first put like my equations, right? This would be the generalized Lotka-Volterra equations evaluated at the equilibrium, but this is zero. And then we would get what? Some sort of Jacobian matrix evaluated at the equilibrium point times my perturbation, and then plus some higher order terms, right? And let's say that we don't care about the higher order terms because around like an equilibrium, if the perturbations are small, everything looks like a linear system. And so then you can see that we have like, this is zero, these we removed. So we end up with just like this Jacobian matrix. And this is a linear system of differential equation, which we can solve. And what you can show is that this Jacobian matrix at equilibrium has to have all the eigenvalues with negative real part for this equilibrium to be attractive, right? So that's the idea of local asymptotic stability. If that's the case, provided that we start arbitrarily close to the equilibrium, eventually like these trajectories will either converge to equilibrium or at least not move away from the equilibrium. So we're left with the way of writing like this Jacobian matrix. And so call f of I, you know, just like the Lotka-Volterra for species I, what we need to do is to just take like the partial derivative with respect to every other species. That's the definition of a Jacobian. And if you do that, you find like that we have for the term ij in the Jacobian, we will just find aij times xi. And then we have a slightly different formulation for the diagonal elements of this Jacobian. Right now we're deriving with respect to xi. And so we find like the growth rate for species I, the interactions with all the other species J, plus another term that comes from the fact that this is really a quadratic equation in I, right? Like because we have something on the diagonal multiplied by xi and we have xi outside like the equations. And as such, we get this quadratic term and this would lead to this extra term aii xi. However, at equilibrium, what do we have? That this is in fact what's inside the parentheses, right? When we write our system like that. And we're saying this is zero, but this is exactly the same term. So this whole thing is zero. And therefore we end up with something very simple. You see like the element ij is aij xi or aii xi, which then means what? That we just have like the matrix of interaction A, and then we multiply each row of this matrix by the corresponding equilibrium when we evaluate this Jacobian at equilibrium, which means simply like that we substitute to every xj and xi their equilibrium value. So then this Jacobian is especially simple for the Lotka-Volterra model. And we know that this Jacobian evaluated at equilibrium, which is called in ecology the community matrix M, has to have eigenvalues with negative real part. So now I have a question for you, which is, what do you think will happen? What would you think will happen to the Jacobian in the case of the limit cycle we've seen before? Right? We said like this, there has to be an equilibrium point. We actually found that there is a feasible equilibrium point. It was sort of in the middle of all these oscillations. But if it were really like stable, as long as we get like through this cycle close enough to this equilibrium, it will converge, right? And then we would have just like fixed densities from then on. Right, which means what? That this equilibrium should be unstable. All right, and in fact, like we can do the same that we're doing here mathematically. We take just like x star, like my equilibrium to be the solution of the system with a m minus r. Then we create this matrix M by multiplying a diagonal matrix of x stars times, this is like the way r does like matrix multiplication A. And then we can look at all the eigenvalues of this matrix M and see whether all of them have negative real part. Now, in ecology, we mostly are concerned with what? With matrices that have contain real numbers, right? Where all the coefficients are real numbers. A matrix with real numbers has only basically two types of eigenvalues. These eigenvalues can either be real numbers themselves, right? So imagine like numbers on the typical number line that we think about, or they could be complex numbers, but when they are complex numbers, they have to be paired, right? What I mean is that you can just like draw these eigenvalues in the complex plane. So imagine that this is like my real part of the eigenvalues. This is my imaginary part of the eigenvalues. And so every complex number is mapped into this plane. And so my eigenvalues could be either be real numbers, right, which would appear here on this line, or if they're complex number and I have a number here, I have also to have another here, right? So like they have the same real part and imaginary part with opposite signs. And so let's look at these. We have only four eigenvalues here, right? And so this one, for example, you can see that there's no imaginary part. The imaginary part is zero. So this would be a negative eigenvalue that would be somewhat here, let's say. And then we have two paired complex eigenvalues, right, that have positive real part here, 0.37. And then they have like imaginary part that are coupled, 2.06 and minus 2.06. And finally, we have another real eigenvalue here, minus 0.61. Are all the real parts of these eigenvalues negative? No. Therefore, this equilibrium that we had for the limit cycle is locally unstable, right? Like if I start even close enough to this trajectory, it will not go back. In fact, what will happen is that it will move away from the equilibrium, at least initially, with a speed that depends on these eigenvalues, right? The smaller, the slowest, in the direction that will be the one given by the eigenvector corresponding to this eigenvalue, or in case of like a complex numbers, like there would be two eigenvectors that determine these oscillations away from the equilibrium. All right, so just to say, this is how we would go about doing local stability analysis, and we will see in a second a way to do even stronger stability analysis. But before we go there, I just wanted to show that this equilibrium is in fact very important in Lotka Volterra, much more so than in other models, because when we have dynamics that are not like fixed point dynamics, right? So imagine that instead of like converging all these trajectories of the densities of the species in time to a point, they say oscillate or they have some chaotic dynamics. The equilibrium, even though it has to be unstable, and we just saw an example of that, it still contains a lot of information on the system. And in fact, it provides us with like the average density of the species in time, right? To do this, what you can do is like just to say, let's take the average in time of the density of each species, right? And we can just write this as this integral. And to make things much simpler, what we're going to assume is that we're in some sort of cycle, right? And that we choose like time zero to be when we start like the cycle, and time t, when do we end the cycle, such that, you know, after a certain time big T, we're exactly in the same place where we start. Right, this will make things a lot easier. All right, and of course we're interested in what, in cases in which like this x of t is always positive, right? Species don't go extinct in this cycle, because otherwise they would not be part of the cycle, and as such we can assume that all these numbers are positive. And if all these numbers are positive, we can take the log of these numbers, right? So we can take the logarithm, and in fact we can write an equation for the logarithm of xi of t in time, right? And the way you would do this like is what, d of log x dt is simply like dx dt divided by x. So it's very easy. So we can divide each equation by xi of t, and so what you can see is that this just like gets rid of the part that we had in front of our equation, right? So if I write, let's another way to write this type of equation that is a little more compact is to say x dot is dx dt is d of x times r plus ax, right? And so now we want to take log of x in time, right? Like this is going to be x dot divided by x, and as such we get rid of this x, right? So we get r plus ax. Okay, so that's like very convenient. We will use this trick again later. All right, so that's like our equation in vector form. Now what we can do is to integrate both sides and basically take the average in time of both sides. And so we just formally write this thing. You can see that here we have dx dt, and then we multiply by dt. And so here, like, the equation becomes very simple, because then we're just going to have like the logarithm of the species at time big T minus the logarithm of the species at time zero. But because we did this assumption that we start and end at the same point, these two numbers are the same, right? So the left-hand side of this equation is zero. And that's why this trick was useful. And now we have to integrate the right-hand side. And you can see that we're integrating R, which is like a vector of constants, so we can take that out. We can take out also the matrix A, because also that does not change in time. And so we end up with this right-hand side, like R plus A times, and now wherever we had a species, now we have the integral, or like the average of the species in time. And the way to solve this problem is to do what? Is to multiply both sides by the inverse of A, right? In fact, minus the inverse of A. And so we have that this minus A inverse R is what? It's the equilibrium X star, right? And therefore, like the right-hand side, which is, like, becomes the X star here, like here in the first place, like where we have R, we have a minus X star. We bring it on the left side. And now this matrix A will be canceled by the inverse of the matrix. And so you recover exactly what you expect. Like, the equilibrium is what? It's the time average of the species in time. So that's why this equilibrium is so important for Lotka-Volterra. Not all models will give you like this beautiful result. In Lotka-Volterra, you can show that this holds also for chaotic dynamics. Of course, taking like the average of something that is non-periodic is a little more difficult, but you can think of some sort of long-term average, or like the average will converge to this number. And now let's take the dynamics of the limit cycle that we had before. And then we can discard the first part of the dynamics. Let me just show you like the figure again, so that you can see why are we doing that. So you can see that we have some sort of initial dynamics that are a little different from the rest. And then it settles in something that looks a little more regular, right? That the cycle repeats over and over. So this first part we call the transient dynamics, right? So it's like the way they approach some sort of attractor that could be a point, in which case we would have an equilibrium. It could be a limit cycle, in which case we have something like what's on the board, or some chaotic attractor, but we always have this initial dynamics. So let's discard those and then take the average of each species in time for the remaining part of the time series. And if you do that, even though like we only run this model for a certain amount of time, you can see that when we take the dynamics, remove the initial transient dynamics, group by species, compute the mean density, and then print it, what we get is the set of numbers, which you can see here, it's very, very, very close to the equilibrium that we had computed, right? So if we were to do this for enough time, right, for a longer time, then you would have exactly convergence to these numbers. All right, maybe this is a good time to ask Jacopo if there are any questions on this first basic mathematics of Lotka-Volterra.
Yes, so there is a question actually about the stability criterion, which is asking whether there are stability criteria for community matrices like the one you presented. So I guess where you have the matrix multiplied by the density.
Right. Yes, there are things that you can say. Actually, this is a good segue for the next thing. For example, so imagine that we have some sort of matrix A, right? And what we can ask is whether this matrix A has only eigenvalues that have a negative real part. And let's say, for example, yes, they have, right? Which means what? That if I were to choose certain densities, imagine that I choose like my D of X star, right, to be the identity matrix. Imagine that my equilibrium is all the species are one, right? Then if I multiply the identity matrix here by any matrix, I obtain the same matrix. And therefore, this equilibrium would be stable for this choice, right? If I could choose, like, for example, growth rates such that all the species have equilibrium one. Of course, what happens is that depending on this axis, I might or might not have stability, right? So the stability does not only depend on the matrix of interaction, it also depends on the equilibrium, and therefore implicitly it depends on what? The growth rate, right, of the system. Is this always the case? Not quite, right? Like, for example, if I can take a matrix, if my matrix A has this property that A plus the transpose of A, right? So imagine that now we're taking a matrix, summing its transpose. What we're going to obtain is some sort of symmetric matrix. A symmetric matrix will only have a real eigenvalues, right? Because we would not have complex numbers anymore. Now, if these matrix, right, which is like basically the symmetric part of A, has only negative eigenvalues, what you can prove is that for any choice of X star that is positive, which is only the choice we're interested in, these will be stable. Okay? So in those cases, even though we can choose the R's however we want, and as long as we these R's yield a positive equilibrium, then the equilibrium is going to be stable. So this is a much stronger form of stability. And in fact, this is exactly the condition for like having only a equilibrium dynamics. And in fact, like that's the way we are going to use right now to prove global stability. Any other question?
There was a question on the actually on the introductory part.
Yes.
And you mentioned the environmental filtering and trait under dispersion. Mm-hmm. And the question is whether these terms are related to natural selection.
That's a very, very good, a very, very good question. To some extent, yes, right? Like what you have in evolving population is that they try to adapt like to local conditions, right? Like by selecting upon like the variance that is in the population. Maybe there are some individuals that have a certain genotype or phenotype or something such that they're more likely to grow in a given environment. So that's basically the same mechanism, right, that would lead to that. Of course, like the time scale would be quite different, right? If I put a lion here, like on campus, like unless they eat like the students, they will not have time to really evolve, a new diet based on something that is here, I don't know, squirrels, right? They just would go extinct. But it's exactly the same principle, at least. And then I see a question that says whether there is a way to determine whether there is a limit cycle based on eigenvalues, and Simon Levine correctly says no. Unfortunately, I would add no, right? It would be, my life would be much easier if that were the case. So to prove a limit cycle, what you need to do is something a little more complicated, which is to basically draw some sort of like a box, right, around like this point, and then prove like that the trajectories cannot cross this box, and in fact they're reflected back. Like that is like the way to show like that these dynamics will be contained in a certain space. And then if you can draw another little box now around equilibrium and show that the dynamics will always go out of this box, now the dynamics are squeezed between two boxes, right? Like, so that's the basic idea of how would you go about showing like different type of dynamics. All right, now let's concentrate for a moment on the simplest type of dynamics, which are like equilibrium points, right? Like that we have trajectories and they do whatever they have to do. They oscillate up and down and whatnot, and eventually converge to some sort of an equilibrium. And in fact, this is connected with the question that we had before. So what we're gonna assume is that we can find a certain set of numbers, like imagine positive numbers that we put on a matrix on the diagonal, we call this diagonal C, such that C times A plus A transpose times C has only negative eigenvalues, right? So this is again a positive a matrix that is symmetric and as such has only real eigenvalues. Imagine that all of these eigenvalues are negative, right? Then our equilibrium point, if it exists and it's feasible, it's automatically stable. And in fact, it's globally stable, meaning we can start the dynamics from any positive densities for all the species, and the dynamics eventually will reach this point, right? And as I was saying, like this is a very, very strong condition for stability, because it says if A is stable and this property holds, then any multiplication on the left by a diagonal matrix with positive numbers, meaning like the equilibrium, will not change the stability, right? This is called destability in the literature, right? So how do we do this thing of showing that all the trajectories go to a point? That is an interesting and difficult question. And in fact, there aren't very many methods, to tell you the truth, because the problem is what? We cannot really integrate these dynamics analytically. We cannot write the solution for this system of very many equations like that are nonlinear. So it's not that I can just say, well, let's write the solution of these equations, x of t for any t, and then I just take t very large and show that it converges to the equilibrium, because I cannot write the solution. So what we can do is to use what is called the Lyapunov function. And the idea of a Lyapunov function is fairly simple, right? We have a system that we cannot write the solution for. What we're going to do is to write some sort of like summary statistics of all the species. For example, imagine I take like the sum of all the species or the variance of the species densities, right? And if I can write a function such that, let me maybe write here for myself. Right? So if I can write a function V of the dynamics, right, of x of t, right? This is my summary statistic. And if I have this property that this V is always greater or equal than zero, right? And then V of x star of the equilibrium is exactly zero. And then the derivative with respect to time of x of t is lower or equal than zero, let's say lower than zero, then what happens? We have some positive function, right? Like this number is always positive when we're not at equilibrium. It always decreases in time. It is zero at equilibrium, which means what? That if we wait for long enough, these dynamics will reach the equilibrium point. So this is the basic idea behind a Lyapunov function. Now, how do we write a Lyapunov function for the generalized local Volterra model? One way to do it is like, let's write it in component form. Like we're saying V is what? Is the sum over all the species I of C of I, which is like a constant that we want to determine, of the density of species I minus the density of species I at equilibrium. At equilibrium minus the density of species I at equilibrium times the logarithm of xi divided by xi star, right? So this part of the equation, you can see it's always positive and it's only zero at equilibrium, right? That's good, that's nice. And therefore, if we choose positive numbers here, it means that the whole function will be positive, right? Because we're multiplying by a positive constant, positive numbers, and we're summing them. So we're guaranteed to have this to be a positive function. How do you come up with this equation? That's an interesting question. Like I like this book by Steve Strogatz. It has this quote that says that divine inspiration is usually required to be able to write these type of equations. This is actually goes back to the work of Volterra. And in fact, like Goh has a wonderful paper on this in 1977. I can put maybe in the chat or add it to the next lecture for you. Right, so now what we're left with is to determine whether this derivative with respect to time of B is in fact a negative, right? And for doing this, I think it's convenient just to do this in matrix form. Right, so we can write this in matrix form by saying there's like a sum, we can put one transpose for that of a diagonal matrix C. And then we have like what? Here we add X, so we get like X dot, right? This would be the
derivative what?
Time of this. And then this part is a constant, so it goes to zero. And then this part here, we would get just like minus a diagonal of X star. And then a x dot divided by a diagonal of x. Let's write log of x dot. Okay. So now we need to do a little trick, which is to say, well, I want to get rid of the parameter r, right? So when I write my equation and I say x dot is equal to d of x r plus ax, right? But at equilibrium, I have that ax is equal to r, right? Ax star is equal to r. So to minus R. So what I can say right now is that then what? That this equation I can write also as d of x a, right? Now imagine that I'm just writing R like this way, right? So then I would get a of x minus a of x star, right? Which I get from here. Because if I change the sign here, I get a minus x star. And so even more compactly, I can say d of x a times delta x, right? The deviation from the equilibrium. Okay, so with this at hand, what we can do is to go on with our derivation. And I think that then I'm gonna stop for the day and just take questions.
Great.
Let me just finish this, Jacob, 1 second. So we have this. Then we can say 1 transpose like C, and then here we just have like what? A times delta X times D of X. And then here we have minus D of X star A of delta X. So you can see now we have like this matrix that is X, this matrix that is minus X. So we can write this as diagonal of delta X. 1 transpose C, and then we have diagonal matrix of delta X and then A delta X, and then diagonal matrix is commute, so we can swap these two, and then we can multiply 1 transpose by delta X, so we get delta X transpose C A delta X. And so now if this matrix CA delta X were to be negative definite, you know that for any negative definite matrix M, let's call it, right, then we have that this is always lower and equal than zero, lower or equal than zero, and in fact is zero only if delta X is equal to zero, which is our equilibrium condition. And then when we're doing this thing, we're basically summing like this term, right, CA component like ij times delta xi delta xj. And you can see that therefore, like we're always gonna sum this delta xi delta xj one time when we're doing the ij component, one time when we're doing the ji component. And as such, only the symmetric part of this matrix will matter, right? We can write exactly the same equation by saying delta x transpose. And then here we put ca plus the transpose of CA, which will be A transpose C divided by 2 delta X. And as such, if we can find constants such that this matrix, this whole matrix, let's call it M, is negative definite, then the equilibrium is stable, right? So that's how you prove a global stability in this case. And that's the derivation that you find here. All right, I think we should like wrap up here, and then next lecture we will start thinking really about assembly and what makes ecological assembly difficult or easy to do. So let's take some questions.
Great, thanks a lot, Stefano. Sorry for interrupting you too early. So yes, so we have time for questions. So please, if you have them, just ask them. I think Simon, if you want to.
Yes, thank you, Stefano. That was a terrific lecture. I just wanted to go back as a philosophical question to something you said at the beginning about the neutral theory. And I don't disagree, but there's two sort of interpretations. One, in using the neutral theory, you're actually assuming that's the nature of the interactions, that they're stochastic. And the other is, you're saying we know that they're details, but they don't matter at the higher level. The same justification, for example, for using a diffusion model for dealing with how animals disperse. And it doesn't make much difference for what you were talking about, but I just think philosophically, I'd be interested in your thoughts on that.
Yeah, no, I agree that there are different interpretations of what do we mean by neutral. Because like we could think, truly species do not interact, that is kind of a difficult philosophical view to keep, like, because we see like lions eating gazelles. They definitely are interacting. At least if you ask the gazelle, you will get a yes for sure. But also, like, we could have maybe like competitors, and to some extent, they sorted themselves such that they have very, very weak interactions, right? Like, because they try to partition their resources, or in fact, like, they could have basically no interaction whatsoever. So in this case, it's not that like they would not have had interactions to begin with. It's just that after like all these pieces are sorted, you know, we don't really have interactions. Or another interpretation is like these interactions don't really matter, like are much smaller than other processes that dominate the dynamics, right? Like all of these are philosophically like a slightly different interpretation of the same phenomenon.
Right. I mean, they may matter a lot at fine scales, but when you coarse grain, they may average out sort of due to law of large numbers.
Yeah. Yeah. And in fact, like going back on that, one thing that I like a lot is, what if we now, instead of having no interaction, we have random interactions?
Yeah.
Then we assemble systems like that. What you find is that like the statistics look very much like the neutral mode, even though it's basically the opposite of a neutral mode, in which like species have much, much stronger interactions. But still, like a lot of the results that you would derive look about the same.
Right. Yeah. And so the other point, right, the other technical point, maybe it's not necessary that I put in the chat, is that you might have a stable Lybid cycle, and the equilibrium point inside is not necessarily unstable. It might be stable with, let's say in two dimensions, there's some unstable Lybid cycle that separates them, and in higher dimensions, some more complicated behaviors that could go on. I don't know to what extent, that maybe you can comment, that's possible in the Lotka-Volterra.
Yeah, Lotka-Volterra, that would not be possible, right? Like, because we have like this much, much simpler model like for dynamics. But yeah, in generic model, we could have much more complicated like dynamics such that a certain area goes to some equilibrium, some other area goes to a Lybid cycle, or an unstable Lybid cycle shuffles like the system between two
All sorts of things, yeah.
It gets really interesting and really complicated. That's why I wanted to do Lotka-Volterra, because it's just like the simplest that you can think of.
Anyway, brilliant overview. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks a lot. Any other comment or question?
All right. And if you don't have any other, like, you can ask them like the next lecture. And or you can go over the notes again, and then maybe some questions will arise, and feel free like to even email me and answer them before I start next time.
Exactly. So Stefano will give the second lecture of three this Friday, so you have time to think about. There is a question actually in the chat. So how does a constraint on the total population, as seen in the replicator equation, change the stability criterion for a fixed point? In other words, does the community matrix for a LV system with and without this constraint have the same stability criterion?
That's a very interesting question. It's too bad that I'm not talking a lot. I love the replicator equation, and I have other lectures on the replicator equation. So the question is, what if we put some other constraints? For example, in the replicator equation is basically the cousin of Lotka-Volterra. The only difference is that now we're tracking proportions of the density of species rather than the densities themselves, right? So imagine that these proportions always sum to one, which means that if one species has to go up, somebody else has to go down because they have to sum to the same number. In the replicator equation, when you're doing this sort of linearization around an equilibrium point, you will always find a direction that is the direction orthogonal to the symplex, right? Like you have a direction in which, instead of like staying such that the proportions sum to one, now all the proportions sum to some larger number or smaller number, right? That direction that is orthogonal to the symplex, you can discard because you don't really care. You know that the dynamics keep keeps the system in the symplex, and as such, this direction, this extra direction, you don't care. In fact, like I would suggest, like maybe I'll put like some sort of like link in the chat, there is a beautiful equivalence between replicator equation and Lotka Volterra. So for every Lotka Volterra, you can write a replicator equation with one more species, where species is not a real species anymore. And conversely, for every replicator equation, you can write a Lotka Volterra system by ditching one of the species.
Great. So, I think if there are other questions, you can ask Stefano on Friday. So thanks again, Stefano, for giving this lecture and everybody to participate. And we'll see each other again tomorrow at usual time at 1:15 Italian time for the first lecture by Marino Gatti. So thank you very much, and see you tomorrow.